Okay. Sounds like the microphone's working. Let's get started. All right, so before I even begin talking, that link right there is to the slides, so copy that down quickly because this first slide is not going to be around for too long. All right, so just 1 second. All right, so my name is Matias. I've been on the Angular team for over 2 years, and I mostly work on ng-animate, and today that's what I'm going to be talking about. So my website is yurimu.com, and that's how I got started with Angular. And this is a sort of overall background explanation of who I am. In 2 weeks, I'll be starting full-time at Google. Yeah. And I was born in Finland. I live in Canada at the moment. And that cloud right there is my blog's logo. And obviously, you guys know what the first logo is. If you wouldn't, get out of the room. Okay, so we're here to talk about animations in Angular, right? And I'm not going to spend time, you know, explaining the basics because this has been the same for almost 2 years and there's tons of material out there for this, but I'm going to explain new stuff. But I can't just hop into the new stuff right away, so I'll just take one or two slides and explain what happens when ng-animate does its thing. So we have CSS hooks and JavaScript hooks that we can use in our application. And the way that it works is we have this internal service called animate, which triggers these animations, which makes these animations happen, right? And then it's up to you to make your own animations to take control. So for example, in an enter operation, which is like something ngif or ngrepeat would trigger, we have a transition or a keyframe. And then we have a starting class and a destination class. We can also use a JavaScript animation to handle it as well. The key thing with all of this is that we have a base class, such as myAnimation or whatever we call it, and all the animations work off of that. Okay, so with 1.4 then, there's been some talk that, you know, a lot of work has been done to it, and it definitely has, but it's not like everything's changed again, everything's broken, no. We still have the same ecosystem of how it works, it's just the internal code is much better. And the reason why we did this is so that we can extend it and add more features down the road and fix a ton of bugs. So what has been improved then? Well, the biggest things are just the way that the code is. Like if you look at 1.3, it's like a 2,000 line JavaScript file with like a black box of everything. Everything's been broken up, and there's a handful of new features that have come as well. So let's talk about one of these. So one feature in particular is that we have improved callbacks. So with the old school method, we had to hook into the element to detect if a callback happened. So if an animation ended or started, now we can have the animate service do it directly. Now, this might not be a huge improvement. It's like, okay, cool, we just changed a few names. But the benefits are that we can have a controller hook into animations to, you know, set states after the animation is complete. And we can, since we are fully managing all the animations instead of animate, we can improve the performance of the callbacks as well. So this is an example of a controller that's using an animate callback to detect when things happen. But, you know, this is code. If you want to see an example, let's take a look at one. So here, if you remember from last year, me and Lucas, we presented together, and we made an ngTube website which had YouTube videos showing on here. Now, this website's using the YouTube API and animations to make it nice and sleek, but one thing that was a problem was that if I go to the player page, the video loads as the animation's happening. But with these callbacks, I can determine when the callback is done, have a loading animation, and then show the video when it's done. So that's the first feature that we've added. Okay, so, you know, this is a small fix, but it might lead to better things in 1.5 or down the road. We might even be able to have a system where we can detect if all UI changes are done. This is a much requested feature in Angular to know, for example, how do I detect if all my repeat elements are done? Stuff like this. So it's not guaranteed, but it's an idea that we're trying to see where it goes. Okay, so another really cool feature is this internal service, well, public service called Animate CSS. And what this does is we can take all the complexity that ng-animate does internally and use it in our own JavaScript code. So instead of having to use something like jQuery or GreenSock, we can just make animations like this, where we have a mixture of adding classes, removing classes, setting all kinds of properties, including styling, and even hard-coded durations, and then we can just start an animation, and it figures all of it out, and it returns a promise so that we can have animations like this and do some really complex things. So So here's a great example, and thank you for the applause. Here's a great example where we have a JavaScript animation, and we want to add in extra styling within the animation, but we don't want to use jQuery. We still want to have this master CSS file, which dictates all of our animations. We can just do this. But once again, we want to see a good demo. So let's see here. Here, for example, we have a collapsing and expanding div element. Now, everyone can argue that this is actually kind of hard to do with CSS alone, because we can't calculate the height of the element just like that. However, what we can do is we can make a JavaScript animation that feeds in that height details to the animation code and then just use CSS to animate it. Another really cool thing is that we can mix in ng class with another animation and then merge the animations together with that animate CSS service. So for example, we're adding a class red and we're doing that height animation. So the code for that simply is just getting used to the animate CSS service and then calling the done method once it's ready. Cool. Okay. So, anchoring. This is a really cool feature. Back in ng-Europe, I talked about something called ng-animate keep and in line with something called timelines. But this feature is a lot more important to have in such a big system as a timeline system. The idea is that if I have one view and another view, how can I translate one element to the other element without, you know, having to have hundreds of lines of JavaScript code to make it work? So if I were to have something like this, two ng-ifs, one ng-if hides when the other one becomes active, how can I make it so that the item that you clicked on is somehow translated to the new item? Well, what we can do is we can add these reference points in between the destination and the starting points and have a shared CSS class. And then we just add an extra CSS style at the bottom called an anchor transition. Now let's see a demo of this. Okay, so we have a list of users. We have two ng repeats, right? I click on one, it shows up in another one, right? So what's the problem with this? Well, the problem is that the animations are very subtle, and I don't know where the value at the top, I don't know if it's going to appear. I have to actually pay attention to see where it goes. But with this anchoring capability, we can just do stuff like this, and ng-animate does everything for you. And then all that was required was that simple CSS class just dictating that we have a transition, which makes it happen. Another really cool thing is, notice how this is blue and this is not blue? So what ng-animate will do is it will find the difference between all the CSS classes and then translate the differences for you. So you don't have to set widths and heights and borders and remove them as this happens. ng-animate just works basically off simple classes. Okay, so another example. Here we have a list of presenters who've been presenting here. And this is a simple directory website, right? We have the index page, and then we have the listing page. You can imagine that the profile page. You can imagine that the profile page is just going to show a bigger image of the user. Well, if we wanted to have this small thumbnail translate to the bigger thumbnail on the profile page, we can use that same anchoring technique. So if I were to click on Lucas's pretty face, you can see that it animates to the spot where it's going to be on the next page automatically. And then if I go back, it brings all of the other ones right to where they're going to go, just by using those hooks. And then even if I go to the same page, if I click on Brad, and I click on myself, it knows exactly where to put it. And you can mix in any combination of CSS styles because it's all class-based. Okay, so future features. With 1.5 and 2.0, now with this foundation, this whole refactor thing, we can add a lot of more features. And there's a few features that are kind of in ng-animate right now, but the API is still kind of being figured out. So let's talk about a couple of these. So we have a player animation, and whenever you start an animation, you get this big object of data. Like, you have a then method, which tells when the animation's done, but you can also pause and resume it. And this API isn't public yet, but in the future we'll be able to pause an animation directly in the UI. So if you have like an escape button, you can pause all the animations on the page and then do something and then continue them. Another example is with custom drivers. If, for example, you wanted to have a mobile-specific driver or a web animations driver take over everything on the page, you can definitely do that with a custom driver. Once again, this will come later on once the API has been figured out. What about 2.0? Well, 1.5 and 2.0 are going to have the same code base. So instead of having the 1.4 code, and then the 1.5 code, and the 2.0 code, it's all going to be the same code, and it's going to transpile down. Just like with Brian's router, this will make it so that the same bugs can be fixed with both frameworks, and new features can be added to both frameworks as well. So we're not going to be abandoning old versions of Angular. What about 2.0? Well, there isn't anything really to show right now, but me and Mishko have been working on this. The idea is that we will be able to have low-level hooks into devices that have more performant animations. So if you think of iOS, iOS's transition styles, you'll be able to hook into the low level instead of having to use everything with CSS, but it'll be in a very automatic way that ng-animate provides. Okay, so ng-timeline. This feature I did announce at ng-Europe, however, it's still being developed, and I called it ng-animate layout, but working on it more, we sort of abstracted it to be called ng-timeline. And this is definitely coming. It's going to take a little bit more time to do because it's coming out for 2.0 and 1.5 and 1.4 later on. And these are the three people I've been working with. Me and Mishko have been designing the 2.0 stuff, and a special thanks to Thomas because he has brilliant ideas for this API. It's been a pleasure putting this together with him. So, ng-timeline by itself. The idea is that we will be able to have a series of events sequenced by order. So we say this event happens, then this one. And it doesn't necessarily have to be an animation. If you think about a wizard, or you think about infinite scrolling, if we could tie that into Angular's core, we could actually have a lot more event-based things happen in a much more convenient way. But when you mix ng-animate into the timeline stuff, that will allow us to have really complex animations mixed with really complex data and have the ability to reverse animations, to pause, to run multiple animations in parallel, all kinds of cool things. Here is a short list of some of the ideas that we have in mind. However, yet again, I can't convince you without showing you a demo. And this is highly experimental, and I apologize for not having a full timeline to show you with ng-conf. Trust me, it's coming this year. So let's take a look. I'm going to go to my timeline code and load this. So if I look in the source, here we have a repeater, which is an ng-if with a repeater, which is just showing a bunch of items. And we have this long ng-timeline code. I'm not going to dive too much into this because the API might change, but the idea here is we have one step and another step and another step, and then we go down further and we actually have parallel steps where we're setting a custom position. So that allows us to do something like this very, very easily without using something complex like jQuery or GreenSock to manage the animations for us. And this is all random data mixed together with this timeline code and these various steps that make everything happen. Oh, is it going to pause? Nope, it's going. And there you have it. This will come later this year. But that is it for now. Here are my contact details. And I will be in the hallway for anyone who has questions. And if you have beer to give me, I'll be happy to have a beer with you to talk about things with ng-animate. But thank you, everybody. ng-conf is great, and thanks a lot for coming.